Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Forbes India Insights Building Resilience with Technology webinar in association with BMC Software. We are joined today by Dr. Neeta Verma, the Director General, National Informatics Center, Mr. Bhuvanendra Kamak, CIO, TransUnion Sibyl, Sharad Saxena, the CTO, Bank of Baroda, Herb Van Hook, Vice President, Strategic Analysis, BMC Software, Hitesh TK, CIO, Vodafone Idea Limited, and Sunil Kumar Thakur, the Country Director, India, BMC Software. Thank you, Dr. Neeta and gentlemen, for joining us today. I would also like to welcome our audience who've taken time out to be part of this discussion. Kindly drop your questions for the panelists in your chat box, and we will take them up at the end of the panel discussion. It's been a grueling few months for millions of Indians, not to forget the many thousands of businesses that have been hit hard across the country. By the end of the month, it will be almost 4 months since India started Unlock 1.0 after a two-month lockdown. Individually, many of us have been confined to our homes. Companies have had to resort to layoffs and pay cuts and dig deep to keep themselves running, which is only expected to recover next year, according to many estimates. Yet, even as the daily COVID-19 cases have been on a phenomenal rise, millions of Indians have also begun to adapt to the new reality. And if you look at it, COVID-19 crisis has also been an eye-opener to many of us, particularly in how we go about our daily lives, our preferences, and approach to many things. Across companies who've also got the role in kickstarting the economy, customer preferences, employee engagement, management styles, and the ecosystem have undergone serious transformation. The crisis also brought technology to the fore from being just an enabler earlier. Technology and digital have been the building blocks on which businesses world over have survived over the last few months, ensuring business continuity, improved supply chain, targeting customers, and mitigating risks. Data-led insights have never been more important to serve customers at a time when consumer preferences are evolving rapidly and supply chains remain fragile. As employees work from home and organizations wake up to the idea of the hybrid work model to cut costs, automating many mundane and repetitive tasks and processes will take precedence. On that note, let me begin by inviting opening comments from all of you, our panelists, on how the past few months have been challenging for you and how that has reshaped your thinking. Let me start with Dr. Neeta.
Good evening, everyone. As you know, NICX is a technology partner to the government, providing IT solutions to the government, managing their own programs, and also delivery of services to the citizens. The IT infrastructure set up by NIC Pan India actually works as a lifeline to digital government. And this spans across Pan India, gigabit, multi-gigabit network, national data centers, cloud, video conferencing services, messaging services, and so on and so forth. So when this pandemic happened, and you know the pandemic and the lockdown happened all of a sudden, our first line of response was to provide video conferencing services to each and every government official to be able to operate and discuss and take various decisions while sitting in their homes. So we really had to immediately scale up our infrastructure to be able to cater, and then also handhold people who were often assisted while they were using video conferencing in their homes. And these video conferencing services were used by all across the government, right from Honorable Prime Minister talking to various segments of society, Honorable President, at the same time, Chief Secretaries, Cabinet Secretaries, and even District Administration, because it was kind of, in fact, some of them use these video conferences and set up their own control rooms and war rooms too. This infrastructure was running almost on a 24/7 and being used by each and every district of India. And then we also had a challenge because it locked down initially for us also to mobilizing people and making sure the initial days, a lot of effort had to be put into really mobilize and make sure how people are enabled to work from home, and while we still provide that scalability and availability to the government. Then, you know, it was 23rd of March and we were very close to financial year. So a lot of government files have to be there. So fortunately, we have a system called e-office, which is a digital office, which through which you can handle all your files digitally. This is already in place for last few years in the government. During this time, this was extensively used by government officers to process their files while still being at home. But we had to enable a lot in terms of moving these systems to highly secure channel so that from anywhere they could move these files. So that became another big thing. And each ministry could very successfully close their financial year. Even going forward, as we move further, you know, there was a lot of requirement of mobilizing of funds or subsidies to all these migrant workers and other people who were in distress. So there again, we deployed technology. We have something called DBT, Direct Benefit Transfer. It's a national platform we have, which was used by central government ministries as well as state governments to transfer the funds directly to the bank accounts of these migrant laborers or other segments of society whom funds had to be transferred. So that was another thing which was done. Hundreds and thousands of crores of rupees had been transferred during this time. Directly, each and every subsidy, whether it was 100 rupees or 500 or 1,000, everything was transferred directly to the bank accounts of those individual beneficiaries. Public distribution, you know, government also came up with distributing free ration to every beneficiary. And also we brought the concept of you could take it from anywhere. We were, in any case, already working on a platform called one ration card, one nation. That means if you have a ration card, irrespective of wherever you are in the country, you could draw your ration from there. You don't need to. And even if you're part of the family is here, part there. So all those things were there. They all were suddenly kind of deployed on a large scale. And we could, I'm very happy that we could successfully do that. So in a way, what we were doing in the routine days, our work was far more than it happened. And then we had to handle with all those challenges of mobilization of people, lockdown, people working from home. But I'm happy we could really cater to all those requirements of the time. Then Aarogya Setu, which many of you know, which we specifically built for providing a technology-driven contact tracing solution to curb the spread of virus. And this is today one of the largest contact tracing app in the world, with 158 million people in India already using it to help themselves as well as to help their families, because they get alerts much before any symptom is shown that they have come in contact with somebody who has turned positive or somebody who was at a high risk. So that way you can take enough steps to protect you. And in case you have some people with comorbidity, you can isolate your step from there. That was another thing which came different.
I think we will come to, you know, Aarogya Setu and how you managed to do that in just a bit. But let me just throw it open to Sharad. You know, how challenging was the last few months, and how did that reshape your thinking during this period?
Thanks, Manu. I think I'll take off from where Dr. Neeta left, and we had similar challenges. This came all of a sudden, and it came at the end of the financial year. So we had to see that the services go on effectively. We are able to service the customers, close the year, the financial year. The biggest challenge was to see that the 24/7 data center operations continue. And then suddenly we realized that there is a huge spike in digital transactions. So we had to see that all these digital transactions flow through effectively, and we had to scale our systems. And when I say we, you would know that we are not just one bank, Bank of Baroda. We just took over Vijaya Bank and Dena Bank. So we had 9 data centers which had to be operated and had to be scaled up. Having said that, I think all crises provide some opportunity. So we had a lot of opportunity, as Dr. Neeta also said. We didn't have a platform for digital movement of files, but we immediately deployed it within 15, 20 days. We deployed a solution and everybody took to it. And I'm very happy to say that not a single paper moves in the office today. then of course the video conferencing solution, and it, people are so used to it now that they travel in the car, and wherever they are, they get onto it. Apart from all that, as I said earlier, that we were amalgamating banks, our amalgamation exercise was going on in full swing, and we had commitments to the ministry and to the RBI, and that came to a sudden halt. But we said that, no, this is not going to stop at this. We have to continue, and we found out innovative ways of continuing. People working from 80 cities, different partner ecosystem, different employees of different units. And I'm very happy to tell you that in this whole pandemic, we have been able to merge the entire Vijaya Bank, and we finished this last weekend. So I think we should not be afraid of crisis. The crisis can bring in best in you. And that's what we have proven it to be.
That's great to hear. That's fabulous news. Let me just come across to Herb here. Herb, from a global standpoint, and from your experience globally, how have companies been adapting to the ongoing crisis? Are there some sectors that will see some phenomenal change over the next few years?
Thanks so much for the question, and thanks to the first two speakers there. I can echo their experience in terms of what we saw at our company and actually with our customers. What's amazing is two things. One, the resilience actually of the people and how much they have stepped up and really made business go forward, and a success of this, and caring for each other. And then also the resilience really of the technology. I mean, it's amazing with the shift in bandwidth and workloads and that sort of thing. All of us are connected digitally, and the internet sort of kept running, right? There was a lot of work to do to make that happen, but business went on almost without a hiccup. We've all had to shift to new working models, like most of you. I've been out of my office for about 6 months. By the way, I'm not in India. I'm just outside Washington, D.C., so a bit of a morning for me. But like everyone else around the world, we're sort of in this thing together. And we've all made it work, which is really important. I think a couple of comments on this, though. One of the things it's done is made all of us rethink how we build, engineer, operate our systems. You know, how we drive more resiliency there. There was actually some terrific learnings and research that came out of Google a few years back around what they called site reliability engineering, or some people call it service reliability engineering. The idea that the keeping our systems up and running is a holistic exercise, that it's not just dealing with an individual component, but it's dealing with the whole organism. The whole estate of information technology. And that discipline and that mindset is getting more and more pervasive in our customer set. And then also, I think it's been accelerated very much by the effects of the pandemic. We believe that automation is going to be very dramatic in the future, playing even a greater role to make us able to keep our services up and running, serve our citizens, our constituents, our customers, and really the way that they expect technology to serve them. And I think this is really a period of time where the digital experts are kind of at the top of their game. So I'm very encouraged by what I've seen the last few months, and very encouraged by the direction we're heading. And like the previous speaker said, this kind of pressure often brings out the best in people.
Fascinating. Let me bring in Hitesh here. Hitesh, during this period, of course, technology has been the big enabler, and it's definitely come to the fore. How did that sort of help with your business continuity during this pandemic?
Yeah, hi, Manu. Manu, from a Vodafone Idea point of view, we had two challenges when this entire pandemic started in the month of March. One was our own mobile connectivity, which we need to provide to our entire consumer, 280 to 300 million customers. And that has become the most demanding service after this entire COVID situation started. People have to get connected. They need a seamless and reliable connectivity. but at the same time provide that the services seamlessly to all the customers. We had a big challenge of operating all our equipments, which is spread across the country. I mean, roughly around 3.7 lakhs of cell sites we have, which has to be maintained and run by various people. But many of the locations are going through lockdown and those challenges. So first challenge was that how remotely we operate all our equipments. Again, not remotely, not from a centralized office, from all the people from the home. So practically on the day in the March 3rd week, the challenge what we had was we were operating roughly around 200 to 240 offices across the country. And one fine day later, we had to operate almost 100 times. Roughly around 24,000 employees has to work from the 24,000 residences. So that was a scale which we need to change. We have to give access to roughly around 150 applications, which these people has to operate day in and day out, 24/7 from the home. It has to be a secured access. We can't directly open it up in the internet. I need to create a VPN connection for all of them. Again, it's not like, okay, next 1 month. I mean, typically we do 50-60 VPN opening in a week or 10 days time. We had to open around 21,000 VPN connections in 2 days. So we had to give the access because then it has to be secured and it has to have a seamless part. This is maybe from an application and operating my network, but that never stops because we had to communicate to my team, communicate to this entire people seamlessly. So best thing we've seen that email continuing on the desktop laptop may be the most difficult thing. We enabled email on mobile for all our employees because everyone have a mobile today. That is not a challenge. So made everyone to access and work over a mobile. Second is, again, they need to collaborate. We need a video conferencing and other thing. Traditional video conferencing cannot handle this type of volume and load. We have to go into public cloud and cloud-based one. And ultimately, what we have seen, we have to get into a lot of automation because we cannot continue the way we are working on. Second big thing, big ticket item we have seen is digitization is a must. We have to move to digital and digitized environment. Otherwise, it is practically very, very difficult to run our operations of this size and scale. And third one, which we've seen where we are very focused from a telco point of view, self-service to my consumer, they have self-service portal, self-service mobile app and everything. But what we have seen is a bigger challenge is when we move employees to their own location and start working, how will I service them? Earlier, there is an end user, engineer is there, he call him, the guy goes to the desktop side of the person, he do the whatever rectification and all that. Now we need to do remote. That is also very challenging. So finally, we created self-service tools. Tools available on their own laptop, they can do the fixes, everything, so that they have a seamless experience. So this is the experience which we had. And like the bank experience and all, we also had the similar challenge. We were two companies. I mean, all of you know, we were Vodafone Idea, two different company. We also have to integrate all our estate. We have roughly around 53 integration tracks we were running from IT stack point of view. And this is the peak time. Our target was completed by June. We had to complete all our integration track. And then this entire thing happened. Initially, there was a setback. People were finding it very difficult to work in a coordinated way, come to a common solution, come an implementation and all that. But over a period of 3 to 4 weeks, we overcome that. Yes, we couldn't complete in the month of June, but we were able to complete it everything by August.
Right. So maybe this thing, Mr. Bhuvanendra Kamath here. What has been your experience? You know, did technology come to your rescue during this period of time? And how did you sort of manage that?
Yeah, no, so I think as a company, we were lucky. We had work from home and flexible hours. So from our infrastructure, we were ready. We just had to scale and just make sure our security. But two, three other points I'll add other than what people have added. I think one is our servicing units, our third-party servicing, the call centers, et cetera. How do you help them get onboarded? So that was one piece and in a secure way. Second piece was our customers, because of the lockdown, we needed more insights. So we quickly made sure that we were able to give daily insights for our customers to react in their own ways, in their own member banks, right? So that was a big second. The third was empathy and, you know, even for our employees as they work, it's also about, it's just not connectivity, it's also about the ergonomics and well-being of, as we spend more working hours just in front of the computer screen, you have now hold up onto the screen, right? So I think these three things were added on top of, you know, the traditional security and work from home and connectivity. So that I would say are the large changes. And like, we really need to evolve into the new digital ecosystem, which everybody is now adopting to.
We will get talking about that. And just let me just bring in Sunil here. Sunil, a lot of organizations within India were clearly left wanting, you know, in terms of adapting to technology. Of course, India is run on millions of small enterprises. So what are some of the challenges they had to undergo during this period? And what opportunity does the current crisis actually give them to reinvent?
Yeah, and Manu, let me bring in the point of view as a technology vendor. We saw all our esteemed customer going through and some of the technologies that all our speakers were talking about. So what was very, very clear was in these times when sudden changes happened and lockdown happened, technology was the savior during the whole crisis. And the biggest help came from the collaboration platforms, Teams, Skype, Zoom. I can't conceive how organization would have worked without them. So when we went out talking to our customers and the discussions that we had, one clear surge that we saw is the higher discussion and evaluation of a SaaS-based solution. So what happened was in the last 6 months, the organization have realized that it is not just their regular employees who had to work from home, but also their key IT resources who are generally expected to be in office or data centers to manage the, you know, business and IT services. Those were the people who were also working from home. So ensuring business continuity and enabling business services in these times was a real challenge. Now, this led the organization to, who had erstwhile probably not been thinking about going the SaaS way, to start thinking about a SaaS strategy. The second change that we saw was you know, the higher sensitization towards data security. With everyone working from home, it gave an opportunity to the evil eyes, I would say, to exploit the not-so-secured system running from unsecured networks from home. And you know, a large population of our workforce was actually working on their personal devices. So security was the top agenda, especially around compliance and vulnerability management in many discussions that we were having with the CIOs. And let me just quote an example and just tells you how deep this could be. This was, you know, about the last weekend when we heard this news that Department of Homeland Security, United States, they issued an advisory to the entire government institution in US to patch certain vulnerabilities within the weekend, Saturday and Sunday. So you can see the importance that some of the security subjects like vulnerability management have attained in these last 6 months. And we are getting a lot of requests around this discussion. And the last one, but I would say not the least, and we talked about it, it's observed around automations. And organizations today, they are looking at ways to reduce human intervention, not just in IT, but in business services delivery as well. Now, automation, we know, you know, it's complex to implement in a multi-tier hybrid application stack. So what happened is it's remained for a very long time more as a competitive differentiator than, you know, and less of a, what I would say, a service delivery mechanism. What this crisis has done is it's brought to the fore so many discussions that we have put off table for quite some time. And automation is one of the key topics that we are having keenly with our customers. So what overall I saw was playing it safe is no longer an option. All the organization must tackle disruption head on, commit to real innovations, and radically reinvent themselves. So what I must just add to this is that, you know, it's never too late to start. The question is, how do we capitalize on the opportunities around and we remain relevant in the years to come?
Right. Let me bring back Dr. Neeta here. Ma'am, during this period, you also brought out the Arogya Setu app. Of course, like you mentioned, it's one of the biggest people tracing apps right now. Now, during this period, of course, people were mostly working from home. So did you have to rely a lot on automation and things like that to bring it up?
Yeah, of course. You know, as you know, in Government of India, we had introduced cloud way back in 2014. And we have our own cloud, which works across the different zones in India. And many of our services actually saw a real peak, you know, a exponential growth in terms of number of users and usage. So cloud really became a foundational block through which you could scale these services practically on kind of a demand kind of a situation. During this time, Arogya Setu is one. Lot of other apps also we introduced, like RT-PCR, which is today used by every lab technician who's collecting RT-PCR sample from, and lakhs of samples are being collected in a real time. That was another app which needed a lot of backend to be provisioned. Just because we had cloud, that was one thing. And of course, automation. So during this cloud services also, I mean, that is one of our agenda to bring it to a close to zero touch kind of a thing. But today still there are interventions. So we definitely managed a lot of automation, but we have also put an agenda to do much more automation in our infrastructure management, because not only the current situation, but time to come, we see the adoption of cloud or the digitization per se in government is again going to increase many, many folds, because people have seen who did not have good digitization have really suffered in terms of their services. So a lot of momentum and traction this has got. So we got to be ready, because we have no right to refuse to any government entity. So we have to give infra to everyone. So automation is definitely going to be one of the key things. But more to along with automation, as some of the panelists have said, cybersecurity is another very important thing we need to see, because the whole environment has changed. People are using personal devices. They are operating from different places. They are operating in almost 24/7 basis. These used to be our checks and balances, which used to put in our system to make system secure, particularly to handle zero-day attacks when you don't have any other defense to do. A lot of these things have really got, the whole system has got really bad. The whole spectrum of fabric has changed. So cybersecurity is another thing where we now need to bring a lot of artificial intelligence, a lot of behavioral analysis to make sure that system itself tells me that something is going wrong with me. So what I very familiar call autonomous system with respect to system detects and kind of self-heals itself.
Sharad, in that sense, would you agree that the banking sector will see some phenomenal, you know, automation happening in the next few years?
Yeah, Manu. I mean, there can't be two views about this. Digitization has been in the forefront. But before I go to digitization, let me just give you what happened just after this lockdown struck us. The RBI announced a moratorium for the asset customers, the people who had taken loan, the company who had taken loan. And this was a period where the lockdown was at its peak. And we had to find out really innovative ways of taking their consent on SMS or interacting with them on various other channels to see that we take care of them. And this whole process accelerated the process of digitization of our value delivery, be it liabilities, account opening, or loans, or as I say, moratorium. So this is on the customer-facing front. On the customer-facing front, I'm sure the digital journey was going on. The government has been emphasizing in form of EASE 1.0, 2.0, now 3.0 norms have come, which are emphasizing on a lot of digitization and analytics-based platform. So that was in any case coming from government and coming from within to be competitive and to be able to serve the customers better. But what is happening internally is people are finding there are huge opportunities within the internal working environment of a corporate. And this is where we are finding that, look here, within the operations of, or rather the technology operations, or even beyond technology, there are huge opportunities to automate, and the dependence on individuals can be reduced. This was on the back burner till some time in the past, but this has come in the forefront and we are actively working towards that. And that is paying its dividend. So there are no two views about it.
Absolutely. Herb, in that sense, what areas of automation do you actually would address the current sort of complexities brought on by day-to-day operations? What are your views on that?
Thank you. Automation is kind of a multi-layered stack for most organizations. Everything from, at the bottom, infrastructure automation for provisioning, configuration, scaling of infrastructure, up through the automation of things such as development processes that's happened around the DevOps kind of movement. The other thing is, once we get above that to the IT processes and then to the business processes, there's a tremendous explosion and automation options and automation technology that people can take advantage of. Everything through the orchestration needed to drive those processes to things like robotic process automation, and then also the injection of artificial intelligence, machine learning in the automation technologies so that they're really easier for humans to use. There's a tremendous amount of automation going around the digitization of paper, being able to move away from paper documents. We've heard the other speakers mention this. And so we actually think that one of the defining factors of many IT organizations in the future is going to be an autonomous digital model where automation is pervasive, it's paramount, and people will continue to look at the manual tasks that go on and the processes, whether they're technology processes, business processes, governmental processes, that can be automated. So the ability to do analysis on that, the ability to bring the right tools to bear, to do the right engineering there. Many, many organizations are building out centers of excellence around automation and that toolbox of technologies they can use to bring to bear on almost any task or activity or process or technology environment they're dealing with. One of the things that's really taught us about the power of automation is the shift to cloud technologies, whereby we've sort of traded hardware for software in many cases. We have traded sort of that capital expense that we've built out over the years, we've built out our data centers, to an operational expense where we're renting infrastructure and platform services. And that world cannot really work without extensive automation. So automation is one of the big linchpins we think of IT organizations in the future.
I would just like to request our audience to keep sharing their questions. We'll take them at the end of the panel discussion. Right, Mr. Kamak, we've been talking about automation. Just one question that everybody has, as we go forward and there's more automation and artificial intelligence and machine learning and so on and so forth, would that sort of put a risk to physical jobs that we talk about?
I think it's more about upskilling jobs. I don't think it's a risk to jobs. So automation, I'll just take off from where Herb said, there's a lot of value learning and upskilling yourself to, let's say, for example, we started automating using CMDB, a lot of discovery. On the development side, it's the CI/CD tools. You continue to do development, but the CI/CD and the DevSecOps just gives you that level of automation and control of improving quality, to say so. How you demand for infrastructure, the whole automation process of getting it, that layer, even our development lifecycle, for example, we are now making everything API as a service through our microservice architecture, so that even inter-department, when people look for, they're making platforms which actually give services. So that there's no risk of the job. I think it's how you bring up the game in terms of services and building platforms and ensuring this whole digital journey for both inside view and for your customers, it's a seamless transition.
Nitesh, everybody sort of spoke about, cloud being a big platform now that everybody sort of needs. What is your opinion on cloud? Has that changed since the crisis actually began, and what factors continue to remain a concern?
So Manu, on the cloud part, it was something which was there in the DNA of telco, because most of our solution systems, everything works on a cloud environment only, whether it is the BS, the IT stack, or if I take the network stack. But what helped us? Yes, it is cloud. And most of cases, in case of Vodafone Idea, most of us are on our private cloud. We have a very few services or platforms running on public cloud. But what helped us? Yes, cloud for the scale up, and that especially when it comes to security, large set of data gathering, and then you want to do all those type of large scale activities on a short period of time, cloud definitely helped a lot. And when I talked about how I scaled my offices from 200 to 24,000, or these level of employees has to work remotely and everything, if we would have been on a traditional infrastructure servers and all that, it may not have been possible to scale up in that level. because we have enough private cloud setup available and we were able to scale it up. But the good other part where the cloud or a cloud services will become really, really critical is when we really get into this level of remote operation. We can't get our engineers to data center to maintain and operate our legacy servers and systems and everything. Then that is the areas where we have seen operating out of public cloud or taking platform as a service like our ERP. We just been moved to a cloud service provider. So it helped us a lot rather than continue running on our own infrastructure and keeping engineers for backup and everything and all that. So in these type of situations, when we can't predict how your people movement can be defined, when you have access limitation, people limitation and all that, cloud helps us on those sides. And then scalability, another thing, definitely it helps.
Absolutely. Sunil, would you agree there are still some concerns that needs to be sorted when it comes to cloud?
No, and actually it is very, very important that, you know, we're talking this discussion because there's a huge amount of interest that's come into SaaS-based technologies and people are moving into cloud, and that's what we got confirmed now. See, there were two big changes that happened during this crisis. The first change was that many organizations gave allowances to set up workplace-like environment at home. So what we have done is, for a huge population of a workforce, the home office is already set up. So this is a great DR strategy. Now, where are these going to go and work? I mean, if it goes to cloud, that would be wonderful. If it was not for this crisis, to set up something like this would have taken years. The second thing that you have to understand is, people can work now from anywhere. And what the organizations have discovered over this crisis is that they will have to adapt. They don't care about the physical location, wherever the employees work for. Think about the job market that will, the employment opportunities that it may generate in tier two and tier three cities. And when you have to connect to them and give services and access to them, what better way than to connect to a cloud and do it? So cloud definitely is the way forward.
Interesting. Dr. Neeta, I just wanted to get an understanding about, you know, what really went through, you know, with the making of Arogya Setu. How difficult was that entire process? And you turned around rather quickly. So take us through that.
You know, Arogya Setu was, when this lockdown happened, before that also you were thinking that how to go about doing it. The various options and solutions were available to us and we kind of picked up. But only thing was that now we had to, these were all, you know, prototypes, and then you had to kind of scale it to, our initial target was 25 crores kind of a people will download, thinking that we had around, 400 million smartphones in this country. So this was a lot of hard work, but a lot of participation from industry, from startups, from academia, and from the senior management of the government. I still remember we had sessions till 12 o'clock in the night, and then everybody's kind of looking at it, because system had to be really go through a lot of rigorous tests before we launched it, because we didn't want to go wrong on that aspect. So not only from cybersecurity perspective, not only from privacy perspective, from the robustness of the backend system, and also from the variety of devices we have, from the inclusive point of view, depending on whichever kind of devices you have, people might sometimes have an older version or older model, Bluetooth, how much energy it will consume, how much battery it will consume. The whole, we had a very powerful team which was kind of putting up, you know, nudging at on different aspects, and with the contribution of everyone, it looks very impossible today if I look at it, but in just 2 weeks' time, we were able to bring such a powerful app. And the journey has not stopped. I mean, since then, still we have meetings and everything. Everybody is kind of thinking of adding new features to it. Like if you look at the latest feature, which was added a couple of weeks ago, is this generating your QR code, through which then can be scanned by any agency. Supposing you're traveling on the airport, or you're going on a railway station or a metro, or going to any public place, let's say mall or a movie theater, you could put machines through which your status could be scanned. And if your status is green, you could be just allowed. In fact, the prototype or a pilot of that, we have already put it in our office complex, where there are no need of guards. Nobody has to come in contact with anyone. As soon as the employees get in, there is a machine where they go. It automatically reads their temperature. it automatically scans their QR code, and accordingly your entry is kind of enabled into it. So that's the kind of a thing which QR code came into this thing. And also we had a lot of challenge in terms of, you know, people talking about privacy and all those things. But the good thing was that before we launched, we were very, very conscious. Being from government, we were very conscious, and we had seen each and everything. It was seen by the third party, and therefore, you know, we could very successfully react to all the questions. In fact, this was the first time in government, I don't know, anywhere in the world, that we had released our source code in open. It was a very, very bold step, but we went ahead because we were confident that as far as privacy is concerned, we have done, privacy has been at its best for citizens. So it's been a good experience that way also. A lot of people in terms of informally also helped us in reviewing it. It's a very participative exercise, very encouraging that how could really, you know, you could really leverage the power of industry, software industry in India, and come up with these kind of solutions.
I think doing that, you know, allayed a lot of fears on privacy post that. So,
you know, put in a benchmark, and if you look at it, I mean, despite all those things, ultimately we've been able to answer satisfactorily. Not only Indian agencies, but a lot of media and international also had these concerns. So the way it has been done, you know, the fundamental, the philosophy was make everything very, very transparent. Explain very clearly what are we taking, where are we keeping, how long we are keeping. And my personal experience, because I've been part of Data Protection Bill of India and also now the new non-personal data coming, that sharing and keeping it transparent has a huge value, and you can definitely ask, and that shows your intent, and that shows your overall motivation of doing good for the public. You sail through all those things. It's not that difficult.
Right. Sharad, when it comes to, you know, the merger of Dena and Vijaya Bank with Bank of Baroda, what kind of challenges did you actually face during that phase, and how difficult is it really managing such a large IT infrastructure?
Oh, so I can cover it in two parts, one pre-COVID and then the post-COVID, rather the current situation. So when we actually, the merger was announced by the government or the ministry, we had two options in mind, do a big bang or do incremental. And there was no precedence to this. The only precedence to this was the State Bank and the Associate Bank merger. But that was, when we met them, they said that it was not so difficult because they were on similar platforms, they had similar schemes, they had similar structures of the databases, and they were operating more or less out of the same data centers. And that is why the merger was quite simple. So when I said that we were having a dilemma as to what should we do, should we go big bang or we should go incremental, we decided that given the legacy of the three banks, the total age of the three banks put together is close to about 250, 300 years. With that legacy and that complexity which will come in, big bang would be a big leap of faith, and we didn't want to take that. So we said that we will go incrementally, and that paid off, and that gave government so much of confidence that they could announce, and they repeatedly, the Honorable Finance Minister said repeatedly when she announced that, look here, Bank of Baroda has done it, and the other 10 banks which are getting subsumed into 4 banks can also do it. Talking about the complexities, since this is the largest and the first of its kind, the incremental migration, what we had to clearly see that when the branches or the customers are getting migrated from one bank to another bank, they don't face any challenge in terms of their day-to-day operations. And their normal life in terms of using old instruments, old MICR codes, IFSC codes, old mobile app, everything continues till the time the customer himself decides, or we decide as a whole that now it's enough. You can come to the other platform. And that's what we did. Till about March, we were only integrating all these payment systems so that they work across the three banks. And after having done that, we quickly started migrating the branches. And there also, we took a very cautious approach. We just migrated one branch, then we went on to 10, And then we kept on jumping leaps and bounds. And you will be surprised to know, in the last tranche, we migrated 900 plus branches and 1 crore plus customers, which is a very big thing in terms of cross-platform migration. And today, I'm very happy to tell you that within next 3 months, we would have taken over the other bank also in terms of the technology infrastructure. Challenges in the COVID times, as I said earlier, there were too many, so many systems, so many partners, so many employees working from different locations. But looking back, I think it proved to be to our advantage that since they were located at their places comfortably and we could give them secure channels to work with, this hassle of travel, gathering at one place, though it was a cultural change because walking across the aisle and talking to a fellow worker and solving the problem was not there. But somehow the people got adjusted to the new normal, the new reality. And now when I meet the team, they say, I think it was good that we got into this mode of working and it has accelerated the whole process. So that's how it is. Absolutely. Thanks.
Interesting. Let me just bring in Hitesh here before I move to Herb. Hitesh, you know, does your organization actually see the current situation as a temporary wave to ride out? Or you think IT needs to be better prepared to handle such unforeseen circumstances? We don't know what would happen again in the future. So what are your thoughts on that?
So Manu, we had already taken a decision that this is going to be the new normal. And we have to be ready. We are already getting ready to work in the new model, and which we called it as, I mean, we started initially calling it as work from home. Now we made it as a policy or a theme saying that it's a work from anywhere. So we are making it completely a work from anywhere office culture or a employee culture into our office. We already started the entire activity. Again, cloud is one of the biggest the helper or I can say the biggest driver here, because a public cloud type of a service is needed for this type of a model. We are moving away from the traditional model of giving our own devices for a desktop or a laptop or an employee. We are completely telling them, you bring your own device, get hooked on to our virtual device farm. You go after that, you connect. Then thereafter, you are on your own maybe cloud drive, cloud email, cloud applications, everything. Anyway, you connect, complete your work, or use this collaboration tools, everything. And this is going to be the way of working. Because we have very clearly seen that whether the situation continues, not continue, we are changed to work in this model. And looking at the way we spread across the country in each village and everywhere, and our engineers and technicians has to be made available, rather than making them sitting in one of the district headquarters or a state capital and then working and traveling everywhere, we have seen this gives a lot of flexibility for the employee to be there on the technical switch or a site where there he can do the job. At the same time, he can be at his own place. Yes, so that is one part we have seen, and we have already taken steps and we started moving in that direction. We have taken a target of by December, we will be completely in that model, and then we'll get rid of this office and other part, and that part is separately going on. The other side where, yes, it's not that easy to do it. From a people side, there are challenges, and especially when you are running 24/7 operation, people have to be there in the night shift and all that. There are challenges, people to operate from home, continuously for a week in the night shift and other stuff. So those software issues are also there, but we are handling it. But if you ask me, yes, we are now heading for this as becoming as a new normal and then start working in that model.
Herb, do you agree with what Hitesh said? Is that the new normal that everybody globally also to follow?
Absolutely, I do. I think this is going to fundamentally change the way people work, the style, the methods they work. We're reevaluating at our company, you know, every week, every month, as to when people can start moving back into offices, or what kind of flexibility we're going to offer them. So, for example, in India, we have a few thousand employees. Our India locations are based out of Pune, and then a few hundred people in Bangalore. Actually, I've got a team in Bangalore that supports our market intelligence function, and speak to them, almost daily. And it's really fundamentally changed the way that people interact. We all do miss the face-to-face socialization, the ad hoc activity that goes on in offices, the random learning that occurs when people come together. But I think people have adapted pretty well to this sort of, we almost hate to say new normal, but it is going to shift the way we work. One of the things we did actually in India was we realized this was going to be a huge disruption for a lot of people. It's very difficult sometimes to do a work from home situation for some people based on space or, getting some privacy with other family members. Here in my home, in fact, I have two of my children that are home from university because their university's closed, and they're in various other rooms trying to get through their classes. So one of the things we did in India was actually fund some fit out for home office space for people. We allocated them a bit over 20,000 rupees to go and procure whatever they needed equipment wise, a desk, things like that. To kind of ease that burden. One of the other interesting impacts we've seen to our business, though, many BMC solutions are rolled out and delivered via SaaS technology. And we have our own cloud hosting service that we do for that, or we use public cloud providers. And a lot of times our customers want those services delivered in their geographic region or even in their country. And so we roll these out around the world. Early on, we had plans to roll out some additional services in Israel. The cloud provider there came back to us and said, I'm sorry, the work from home demand has actually spiked our capacity. We don't have the capacity in the cloud environment there to handle you, and we had to look for alternatives. So there are constraints that are introduced into the system as we make the shift. But overall, for the last few months, it's been pretty amazing, the transition and the success we've had at executing this work from home model.
Let me just bring in Mr. Kamak here. We all spoke about cybersecurity being a big concern here. So give us some insights about how you're particularly, for your organization dealing with, issues related to cybersecurity and even, other IT issues as we move, into location agnostic models.
So there are two parts to this. I think cybersecurity, right from perimeter security to endpoints, there's enough technology to take care of that. But more important is as we make sure we roll out new facilities, whether it's work from home or new applications and the rollout pace which is happening, how do you integrate the whole DevSecOps process into it? That security component as a component of building should not come at the end, but it should be part of the process. I think that's a big one. The second piece is the way we manage our infrastructure. Like, Sunil talked about a security patch coming up and it had to be done over the weekend. How do you identify that infrastructure quickly? How do you discover? How do you make sure you've got it all covered? The whole responsiveness to that. The third layer is obviously, all about event and incident management. How do you have your SOX control and enhance that? And make sure that you are more proactive in this so that your signatures are learning faster. And obviously, we're using a lot of now ML and on our logs. So we've established a lot of log analysis to make sure that we are proactively able to catch changes. So these are some of the, more deeper embedding into the cultural sort of effect to make sure data security is more enhanced.
Right. Sunil, I just want to bring you in here. And just before I do that, we are about 5 minutes from closing the panel discussion. So request our audience to kindly send in the question. I've got a few. But please send more for our audience, for our panelists. Sunil, when it comes to cybersecurity, are Indian companies actually quite proactive, or are they just sort of waiting for some event to take place before they really go all guns blazing?
Tricky question. Manu, I think what this pandemic has done is it's brought that to the fore. Everybody knows that needs to be done because of so many ways people were trying to connect back into the organization. And it will be a big part of the agenda. I think the amount of time that we have invested in security in the past, we would go multifolds into what we are going to do in future. I'll give you one example of what Herb was talking about. For us, what we did is in BMC, we have about 2,000 employees in India, and they do the R&D, they do support, so many different functions. They reside out of India offices in Pune and Bangalore. We had moved so many of our employees to laptops over the last few years. And when this pandemic struck, they could all carry their devices back home. Now, that was a huge boon for us because the security, the compliance, the vulnerabilities, et cetera, were taken care of by it. And what they all had to do is we had to provide them the right VPN access to come and access all our internal applications. And what we were thinking of is this VPN should hold on and it should do it. It held on, it did well, and it moved on. But security is definitely come on the table, and there are many ways to look at it.
So on that note, I think we will just start taking the questions from the audience. So I have got a few questions, and I will read them out, and whoever is willing to answer that, kindly. The first question has come from Amrita Yerikar. What kind of disruptions do our panelists foresee in talent acquisition, especially campus recruitments, that seem to a major metric among education institutions in India? Maybe I can start with Dr. Neeta, and then I can ask one more person to answer.
So I feel as far as talent acquisition is concerned, with these kind of new models of working, we'll have a lot of these talents coming from tier 2, tier 3 cities. And also, many a times, we have seen that people, with the use of these various models of AI and all, many a time, a lot of this talent acquisition itself is being supported by the technology, and which does a kind of a 360 degree analysis of a person then onto this. But largely, I feel new models will enable, particularly I personally feel for working women who have left jobs in between, it will open up a new kind of opportunities. Because often you're very talented, your home situation doesn't allow you to go to office, but you can contribute significantly from home. So those opportunities which were much less, this new way of working will open a lot of opportunities for that workforce. And I personally very feel very good about it, because it will perhaps bring the gender parity in the organizations, which is also a concern across all corporates and government.
Herb, would you like to answer that question? The question was about what kind of disruptions do our panelists foresee in talent acquisition?
My experience, we're still hiring, and we haven't seen much change there, other than the difficulties, obviously, with things like face-to-face interviews and things of that nature. Luckily, a tremendous amount of talent sourcing, recruiting, vetting has been done digitally by us for quite a while. We schedule remote interviews, remote calls. I actually have a requisition that's open right now we're attempting to fill. It's in Bangalore, as a matter of fact. And we're not really seeing much disruption or much change for us there. There are some challenges just because of the distance imposed by the digital technology. But overall, we have not seen the type of effect on our business at all.
Thank you for that. So the next question has come from Dinachandra Usham. With the rise in digital transactions, especially during the lockdown, cases of cybercrime or digital fraud seems to be on the rise. What are the preventive and punitive measures needed to foolproof them, foolproof from these issues? Let me bring in Sharad here. Sharad, what are your thoughts?
So while the number of transactions have gone up, and I don't know what statistics is being referred to about the number of cyber crimes also on the rise, this has always been the case, as in the cyber crimes and prevention of cyber crimes or any other form of cyber crime has been always on the top of the agenda. So this is something which is which an organization continues to work, engages with the industry, engages with the cybersecurity agencies, with Government of India, top down to various other agencies which are there. And this is dealt with at number of levels. At the topmost level about the threat to the country, the software or the infrastructure, we should not use of certain geographical geography of origin because of certain problems over there, as you would know in the recent past it happened. From there onwards, right to the grassroots level of how the code is written, how the perimeter security is there, and are we applying the patches. So this is something which is a continuous process, and there is no let up in that. Having said that, during the pandemic, yes, since the volumes were large, and there were a lot of attempted attacks, because there were in many organizations we figured out that there were lapses in the security, or because of unavailability of manpower, there were certain gates left open, ajar. So there were attempts, but I think everybody has rose to the occasion. They have geared up. There have been a lot of advisories. We have been complying to that. Apart from normal compliance, internally as well, we have taken that into account, and we are meeting very regularly and reviewing our situation. So this is something which is not new, pandemic or no pandemic. This is always on the top of the agenda.
Mr. Kamak, would you like to answer that question? And would you want me to repeat it?
No, I have the question. So I'll just add a bit more to this. I think one is identity check. And there are two types of identity. One is from the device itself. So, for example, you know, we help find out whether the device, let's say it's your mobile, is it a rooted device? Has it been used in unknown traffic? So one is protection against the source itself. The second piece is, you know, how do you identify the person who claims who he is? And obviously then is the authentication piece to say, did he create that event, whether it's a payment or buying or, you know, he's borrowing. So is it that person? So identification then, you know, moves on to the network level, and where you have the customer identification, where you tokenize them and so on. But the first two also play a real important part, just to make sure that at the source itself, you can prove the identity of the person is the right person.
Thank you. This other question has come from Mr. Shekhar. How will your attitude towards technology strategy evolve as a leader post COVID-19? I think that question can be answered by everyone. So I'll just bring in Sunil, and then I'll just move around and ask. Sunil, you're on mute, Sunil.
Hey, sorry about that, Manu. You know, what has happened is, and I've seen this as a distinct change for the business leaders, the reluctance in adopting technology is changing into investment in technology mindset, particularly around, you know, SaaS, automation, security, and so much. So clearly, we know that in this crisis, technology is what steered us or helped us to come out of it. And as we move forward, all these things are going to have a far-reaching impact as technology gets a lot more deeply embedded into all the human interactions. So I'm sure the attitude towards technology has significantly changed. I can feel that in so many conversations that I've had with many leaders.
Right. Hitesh, how do you respond to that? How will your attitude towards technology strategy evolve as a leader post-COVID?
I will just echo what they said. I think there is there's a considerable change now towards when it comes towards technology now. Like earlier, it may be a deep analyzed investment decision, but now it is becoming part and part of the game, and it's a must. It is becoming a must. So the strategy towards technology, strategy towards many of the latest technology, that is another big change in trend I have seen. Earlier, we will always prefer to adopt a technology which is well proven, already there in the market and everything, which was the first adoption was there. But now the completely change, modernization and latest technology is what is getting adopted. Like in our case, we were a traditional video conferencing and other part. There was nothing like
just adopting a Google Meet when this crisis started. And once they started, then they are only interested more and more in similar type of services. So yes, there's a complete shift and there's a complete focus towards technology.
Thanks, Vlad. This is a specific question for Dr. Neeta Verma. A lot of people still fear downloading Arogya Setu app given the privacy concerns. How are you tackling that?
See, in Arogya Setu, it has basically three principles. One is principle of minimality. So if I don't know if there's a time or some that way, if you read the terms and conditions of Arogya Setu, how it works, the way it is given there, it exactly works that way. In a very, very nutshell, that your data resides on your phone itself till you decide to share with this or you turn positive. Otherwise, it is there. Only last 30-day data is encrypted on your phone. While transmitted also, it is on an encrypted channel. And on the server also, it has a limited time where it stays. And anytime when the information is shared, it is only your DID number, which is a number given to every installation of Arogya Setu or every phone. Only that information is shared. And in Arogya Setu, now when the person tells orange or something, we also tell them that how have you turned orange? What exactly? So we tell them that you've come in contact with somebody who has become positive or who was at high risk. There also, only we share the information at what place you met, what was the time, but we never disclose identity. In fact, we don't even transfer the identity of the person to the server. And now the source code is there for you. You could always, and you've seen it's been there for now, since April we had opened it, it's been there and there has been no finding by anybody in terms of, you know, any other information than what is there. So my request is read those terms and conditions and the policy. And I assure you, whatever is mentioned there, the same is being followed. Source code is also there. So releasing a source code has really, quieted a lot of those concerns up thereafter.
I hope Nandita is satisfied with that answer. Let me just bring in Hitesh, I think, because this is a specific question again to you. During the pandemic, the countries and the globe's internet infrastructure faced unprecedented demand thanks to remote work and social distancing. Enforced lockdowns. How are you able to cope with this, with the many challenges involved for your employees and customers?
Yes, this was one of the biggest challenges we had faced. Okay, again, to a large extent, technology helped. It is now, when you look at it, most of the capacity augmentation from a physical infrastructure augmentation. I mean, definitely it is there, but that is moving on to a cloud infrastructure. Most of the capacity augmentation now gone into a software augmentation. Maybe additional licenses, additional capacity you will be able to handle it. But when it comes to the physical infrastructure augmentation, to a large extent, it helped because we had moved almost all our technology infrastructure on a cloud-based architecture and mainly working on edge computing and all that. So that was the first thing helped us to augment our capacity because we had gone almost like three to four times in our data, the utilization when this entire thing started. And another big change also, we normally used to have a very heavy data traffic in cities and A-class cities. After pandemic, everything shifted to rural. And there are many other places we may not have the capacity. But then we shifted capacity from cities to the rural. So all this work has been done. Yes, well planned. Again, planning also some of the earlier discussions we had done. If it was done through a manual planning, it would have been a disaster. This is where, again, automation, machine learning, and a lot of data analytics helped us to plan much, much earlier, saying that, yes, the data traffic has started shifting from cities to rural. It is better to shift capacity also from city to rural. So technology plus large set of automation, and then some of the modernization helped us to manage the capacity.
So this is the last question, and it is, as social distancing remains a norm, how will you make your workspaces safe for employees, and will it call for more automation and digitization at all levels? I think everybody can answer this question. Maybe we can start with Herb and then just ask her.
Sure. Our People and Spaces team have put a lot of thought and time into this, as well as the building owners where offices exist. So, for example, the building I work out of, they have put a lot of signs around, providing a lot of information, made a lot of you know, things like hand sanitizers available. But pretty much you cannot go into a building or an office without wearing a mask, a face mask. You cannot be in any common areas such as lobbies, elevators, things like that without a mask. The elevators have been limited to number of passengers based on their size. They will have sticker circles on the floor showing how many people could be there. And our offices have been sort of de-densified. The number of people we permit in an office is much less as we have started slowly beginning to open our offices. And then also you have to have really special permission at this time to return to the office for any reason. There has to be a real business reason for you to be there. Eventually, we believe, of course, as everyone does, the pandemic will eventually come to an end through natural means or through vaccines, et cetera, and we'll go back to more people in the offices. But right now, we're playing it very, very, very slow, taking things very, very much one step at a time.
Sharad, would you also like to respond to this question?
Yeah, I will take off from where Herb left. All those type of precautions or measures, if I may, are being taken in our office as well. But I think the impact is far-reaching. And there is already a discussion within the top management with HR as to how do we take this forward. Do we say that a certain number of employees will always be working remotely? And we are not talking about work from home. We are exploring the opportunity to work remotely. We might have offices. I'm just thinking aloud of what, or rather echoing what has been the thinking within the organization, that why not have offices without any nominated desk, and people nearest to their those locations can travel and work from those locations if they have to. Otherwise, they can work from home. We have also planned on certain employees, or so to say employees, in the, not in the real sense of the permanent employment, but we can work on certain projects and then get away, which is not the case in a public sector organization, but we are planning for that. We are also planning as to if there is a prolonged period of such activity working remotely, then what are the various imperatives in terms of team building, in terms of emotional well-being of that person, or maybe in terms of monitoring as to are we getting the output which we took that person for. So these are various aspects we are discussing with the organization, and we are taking some measured steps in that direction.
Interesting. So I think with that, we've come to the end of the audience questions, and we will just, you know, we have very little time now, so we will move towards closing comments from all our panelists. I think the question is essentially about the way forward, and maybe what are the three big changes that you see taking place as we go into the new normal, as they call it. We can start with Dr. Neeta and then move around.
So first thing which I see in government is work from home and virtual meetings is going to be a new normal even post-COVID. It may reduce a bit, but that's going to be there. So we are trying to scale our infrastructure. In fact, we have built a specific platform for work from home where we've integrated all common applications which any government official has to interact from time to time. Second thing is, I mean, what we have realized that the story of digital India is not going to be through laptops and desktops. It has to be primarily access channel, has to be mobile. So how do you convert all these citizen services and all other kind of systems to be more accessible from mobile? So mobile first kind of a thing. Also, the way you have now seen the way schools have connected to children, the students for the whole education, the way hospitals are connecting to patients over teleconsultation platforms, or way judiciary is hearing cases nowadays where neither the judge, not the litigant, not the lawyer, nobody is going to the court and the cases are still being heard and judgments are being given. So in these kinds of scenarios, what to make sure that the people of rural India also get the similar advantage as the people in urban cities, we need to further enhance our digital infrastructure. And therefore, this announcement by Honorable Prime Minister of making the broadband go to 600,000 villages in India will be a big game changer, so that they also get the same kind of experience in education, in entertainment, or in their access to services, or in healthcare, which is a major thing. It will be a big game changer. And finally, automation in any case is going to be under underlying theme for all infrastructure management.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Let me just bring in Mr. Kamak here. Your closing comments, the three big changes you see, you foresee in the new normal now.
I think three big changes over and above what other people have said is, one is agile. You know, we were planning originally to have co-located teams for agile teams, but now with these collaboration teams, we did a last PI fully on a collaboration tool with breakout areas. So even now, agile has learned how to work from home. The second piece is obviously the cloud readiness. And third most important is platforms as a service and the API service, and being a digital API-led ecosystem is the three large changes I see which is happening.
Thank you. Let me just come across to Mr. Sharad Saxena. Your closing thoughts, the big changes you foresee in the next few months?
I think there will be a renewed impetus and fast tracking of digitization of banking services, which was in the process, but I think that will get accelerated because this is the way how the big banks are going to work. I think the brick and mortar model of banks will be up for review because it's expensive, and we have seen that the banking system can still work without brick and mortar. So I think that will be under big review, and that will be big relief as well because that's an expensive model. That's the second one. And the third one will be a huge amount of automation and bringing up of a lot of cognitive technologies, be it something as small as replying to emails or WhatsApp banking and so on, to something more as to how do we do credit assessment and risk management and so on and so forth. So cognitive will come in a big way.
In that sense, do you think what COVID-19 has done is what demonetization couldn't do in that whole shift towards digital?
I think what COVID-19 has done is what CEOs and CTOs could not push with vigor, the COVID-19 pandemic has pushed.
You know, one big thing demonetization done which became handy was this digital payments. The way digital payments we have seen picked up and really made services, you know, cashless, has been a big boon. So
and we could see that you know, with the UPI numbers over the last few months.
Yes, there have been a phenomenal growth in those numbers.
Right.
I fully agree.
Right. Herb, your closing thoughts, big changes that we're going to see over the next few months?
Well, I think we'll all get, we'll continue to get better at this, improve at this, and we'll continue to rethink actually how business is going to be conducted in the future. This is, I agree with the speaker that said, this is an event that's pushed through a lot of action, a lot of activity that we probably should have been doing all along. So there's a positive side effect to the difficulties and the tragedy that this pandemic is wrought upon the world. But those of us that are in the technology industry, I think, can probably stand pretty proud in terms of the accomplishments that have happened, that we've really, you know, helped keep the world working, help keep people connected, and help keep people productive and moving forward.
Right. Hitesh, your closing thoughts?
Yeah, I mean, just three thoughts, which Vavana anyway had mentioned, which is a work from anywhere, which is one strategy which already we have taken. We are not saying home, like others mentioned, it is can be anywhere. That is one. Second part, which we, again, a strategy which we are working is now mobile first, because today we use mobile for self-service for our own purpose, but tomorrow our plan is that use mobile even I want to do a service for my customer, or even I want to do my day-to-day office work. And the third one, yes, we all saying this technology and all these latest ones helped us to cross this situation. But I think that is not won't going to stop that. So we have to further modernize our environment. So that is another thing which we have taken. Keep modernizing your estate, be it IT or be it the office space or whatever, and so that any further improvisation or any other digitization is much, much easy for us to adopt.
Thank you, Hitesh, for that. Sunil, I come to you now. Your closing thoughts on, you know, the three big changes you see in the next few months.
Yeah, so I will make generic comments because there were some very nice points made by the speakers in the closing comments. The next 5 to 10 years will change the fundamental questions that all companies will ask themselves as they think about success. And the other thing that, you know, is very important is we're going to use a lot of AI and machine learning based, user experience based, so that the interface technology feels a lot more human, you know, and it's delivered through the channel of choice for the consumers, like what Hitesh was talking about, mobile or iPad or whichever way they would like to come and consume. So we're going to see a lot of shift. So this is related to those changes.
Right. On that note, I think we can come to the end of the session. So we would like to thank our panelists for their time, for this taking time out for this event. It's been a fabulous discussion and an insightful one. We had perspectives from the government side, from the private sector side, and, you know, the role of technology, automation. So from all of us at Forbes India, we wish our panelists and the audience the best during these really trying times. And in staying safe during this period.